If they want, as I believe they do want, long-term security for their country, then they will have to embrace those things, arrive at a settlement around those parameters. And I think it's vital for Israel that they do so. The Arab Spring brings many benefits. It has many. It's a hugely positive thing for the world on the whole. But I don't think Israel would want, in the democratic politics of Egypt and Libya and Tunisia to come, in the years to come, a bidding war among different parties about who can become more hostile to Israel because the Palestinian issue is not being settled. And that is a danger for Israel. Also, they face Iran. Their nuclear program is a major threat to peace in the region and the world. And to focus on facing up to that threat also requires making the agreement with the Palestinians. It is vital for Israel's security that they do so.
Do you think the Israelis feel today under siege and demonized around the world?
Your question was, right, do they feel like they are under siege? And I think they, if they're not careful, they will end up more under siege than they feel today. And that's why it's so important for them to try to act decisively and with the necessary generosity, reciprocated on the Palestinian side, to try to arrive at a two-state settlement with the Palestinians.
I mean, we saw an attack on the Israeli embassy in Cairo.
Yes.
We know that the Turkish government had demanded an apology, which did not happen.
Yes,
you know,
right,
that there are other problems that they thought they had before the Arab Spring, good relationships,
yes,
which no longer exist.
That's right, yes. And certainly those things have moved against Israel in recent months. But it would be the wrong reaction to that, to circle the wagons,
right, right,
and say we're going to take on the rest of the world. Israel needs friends and allies and long-standing friends, such as the United Kingdom, and such as the ministers who make up the British government now, who do not compromise on the security or legitimacy of Israel, are urging them to make the necessary steps towards a resumption of negotiations.
What do you think is going to happen in Egypt? Obviously, there have been additional protests in Tahrir Square.
Yes.
The army has not eliminated emergency rule. They have not yet had an election. And
yes,
there's real concern about the future.
Yes, there is some concern. I don't think we should be concerned about all of those things. As you say, they've not yet had an election. Actually, I was one of the people who advised them not to have it too quickly.
Because the Muslim Brotherhood were more organized than everybody else, or for some other reason?
Yeah, yes, well, that's one way of putting it, because new political parties hadn't had the chance, right, to develop. And I think they are still struggling to develop on a coherent national basis. Mm. Now, we must be careful not to lecture the Egyptians about how to conduct their affairs. You know, it is their revolution, it is their country, and they are not going to adopt an exact replica of Capitol Hill or the Houses of Parliament and say we're having a democracy just like Western countries. But we do want them to be able to have an economy that's more open to Europe and vice versa. We do want them to develop the attributes of a genuinely open and democratic society, and we should be ready to help them with that. We have to find a way of helping them without preaching to them. And that's part of what's going on in New York this week. We will have the G8, the Deauville Partnership meeting of foreign ministers, the G8 with the Arab foreign ministers, working out how we do that.
Join us online at charlierose.com.